Every couple of years, as part of this massive general social survey, Americans are asked the following question. Generally speaking, would you say that most people can be trusted or that you can't be too careful in life? So I'm going to ask you the same question. So how many of you feel that people can be trusted in general? How many of you feel that you can't be too careful in life? Okay, you are a far more optimistic crowd than the average respondent to the survey in 2014. But one of the things we've noticed is a steady decline in American society in how much people trust people they don't know. This decline is most stark among those damn millennials that we were just talking about. Just 1 in 5 millennials believes that people in general are trustworthy. So what's striking is that this isn't an isolated statistic. The Edelman Trust Barometer, which is sort of the gold standard for how much trust there is in institutions, fell by an unprecedented 23 points in the United States this year. So these and other signals are leading a lot of people to believe that there is a crisis of trust in society today. I'm here to tell you that it's not really a crisis, it's a transition. We are moving away from institutions that historically provided trust for business and trust in society, and towards a new family, a new generation of digital institutions that are going to provide business and social trust in the future. And these institutions are typically branded digital platforms. So before I get into a few examples to make my point, let's have a working definition of what trust is. I like this one, a willingness to commit to a collaborative effort before you know how the other party will behave. This is a good definition of commercial trust. It's a pretty good working definition of trust in romantic relationships as well. I see some people frowning as they recall past breaches of commitment in romantic relationships. The idea that digital platforms can facilitate trust, commercial trust, is perhaps illustrated really well by the dramatic rise of Airbnb. Think about it. You don't know what that guest is going to do when you hand over the keys of your apartment to them. You don't know how reliable that host is going to be when you agree to sleep in their spare bedroom. And so how does Airbnb get so many people to actually trust these strangers in these high-stakes situations? Because, yeah, the millennials who don't trust people are flocking to Airbnb, but it's not just them. This is a count of how many people were staying at the world's largest hotel chains on New Year's Eve last year. It's dwarfed by the number of people who were staying in an Airbnb, and Airbnb's growth trajectory is that, the hotels is that. And so this is clearly mainstream. This is clearly how the world's short-term accommodation is going to be provided. And how Airbnb does it is by combining a set of different digital cues, some that are natively digital, some that are digitizing real-world sources of trust. So you can hold your license up to the webcam and have it digitized and have it validated in 30 seconds. The social capital that we've built in the real world is now being digitized through platforms like Facebook and LinkedIn, so that can be brought online. We can learn from the experiences of others by reading their user reviews. And of course, there's the brand of Airbnb. So that agglomeration put together creates a new digital trust institution that has reshaped the short-term accommodation industry. It's not an isolated example, though. I've seen examples of platforms like this for consultants, for lawyers, for public relations agents, in early examples in healthcare, in energy, even in grocery retailing. There's a wide array of examples in transportation. Many of you are familiar with Uber, if you lived in China, with Didi, Lyft, Gojek, Ola, Grab. But my favorite example from the transportation sector of a trust platform is a company called BlaBlaCar. BlaBlaCar is a relatively small company, not that small. It's based out of France. And what they facilitate is, my colleagues think that I like BlaBlaCar because I like saying BlaBlaCar. It's a fun word to say. But what they do is they allow you to sell a seat in your car if you're driving from one city to another. So let's say you're going from Paris to Lyon, you're driving from Munich to Hamburg, you're driving from Madrid to Barcelona, you're driving your snazzy new BMW 7 Series. You can advertise seats for sale, leather seats, like, you know, good leg room, tinted glass. You can advertise playing soft jazz, say that you don't smoke, you're not too talkative. They even have a rating that you can give yourself for how talkative you are. You rate yourself as blah, 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 or blah, blah, blah. And it's funny because the number of people who are making this leap of trust, getting into a stranger's car and saying, drive me to another city, those are all the blue dots there, is growing every year. Every 3 months, BlaBlaCar carries five times as many people as the French train network Eurostar. Today, there are three times as many people on BlaBlaCar as there are on Amtrak. And so without investing a single dollar in steel or concrete, they have created, using just a digital trust infrastructure, a global transportation network. And this is the power of digital trust in many ways, and it's part of the reason why I got so interested in them, because you know, any company that is convincing people at scale to sort of take that leap of trust and get into a stranger's car and say, drive me to another city, is worthy of attention. You know, my mom always told me, don't get into strangers' cars and ask them to drive you to other cities. She also told me not to sleep in strangers' bedrooms, but by the time she told me that ship had sailed, like, you know, much before that, so that was sort of a lost cause there. But anyway, I surveyed people who use BlaBlaCar in 11 different countries about 3 years ago, because I was trying to understand what caused them to make this leap of trust. And one of the findings was sort of stunning to me. People who use BlaBlaCar will trust a stranger with a full BlaBlaCar profile at a level that is higher than the level of trust they place in neighbors and colleagues, at a level that is way higher than what they place in a social media context. So this is not digital blindness. And at a level that is approaching the level of trust they place in friends and family. And this was consistent across all the 11 countries that I surveyed BlaBlaCar users in. And so, you know, my first theory was that people who use BlaBlaCar just have really lousy neighbors and colleagues. This is why they're jumping into strangers' cars and saying, drive me to another city. But, you know, a more reasonable explanation seems to be that it's not just that the trust infrastructures have become really robust, it's that our confidence in our ability to read these digital trust cues and make assessments about things that we don't know has also improved in the last decade. We've been reading those Amazon reviews, like choosing restaurants based on Yelp, you know, vacations through TripAdvisor. And so our own confidence in our ability to read the digital trust cues and make assessments has improved. And this is what has led to sort of the emergence of this fifth wave of trust in commercial history. I'm a big believer in learning from business history, and I think about the evolution of trust. Initially, we just used to trade with people we knew. And then government regulations for food primarily came along, and so you could buy milk from like the person in the neighboring village and know that it was milk and not rice powder mixed with water. And in the third phase, along came courts and contracts and other economic institutions, property rights. The last 50 years on the consumer side, trust has largely been driven by brand. You go to Think Coffee, you know, you don't ask them for a contract, you just expect that the coffee will be as good today as it was yesterday because they want your business tomorrow. But now we're in this fifth phase of trust through digital community. And the reason why I'm asking you to pay attention to this on your first day as MBA students is because I believe that if you understand the evolution of commercial trust, you understand the evolution of business. As sort of the trust infrastructures evolve, the business models will follow them, so that the way that we organize the world's economic activity in 20 years is going to look very different from what it does today, and that is largely because of the emergence of these new trust infrastructures. I'm running out of time, so I'll conclude with a quick observation on moving from commercial trust to societal trust. It struck me that Facebook and Google and the other large digital platforms are not just bigger than the largest nation states the world has ever seen, they've also started taking on very government-like roles. Their power in society, in some sense, is starting to look like that of, say, the Medici family or the Catholic Church in medieval Europe, where there was sort of this jockeying of power between these institutions and nation-state governments. A lot of people think that I'm overstating this, but if I look at what these platforms are doing today, censorship is done by YouTube and Facebook algorithms, not by nation-state governments. Google has far more surveillance capability than most nation-state governments. Money used to be backed exclusively by governments. Now you have Bitcoin and Ethereum backed by code and a crowd. What I can do with my music and my books isn't shaped by copyright law. It's shaped by the license I have with Apple or Amazon. My Facebook ID is more important than my government ID, and the list goes on. And so my message to you here is that you know, as we enter a world in which these digital trust institutions are central, not just to business, but to society, it's really important that we have a playbook. We're going to have decentralized blockchain-based exchanges for transactions. In 20 years, we'll have millions of autonomous vehicles. We have to trust the intelligence in their systems to sort of carry us safely as part of our urban transportation networks. We're going to have augmented reality technologies and 5G networks, and we have to trust these platforms to reshape reality in a way that's good for us. We're going to imbue autonomous weapon systems with artificial intelligence, and we have to trust their judgment on when to, when not to take a human life. So the kind of playbook that we need has to look for five things. It has to look for how much transparency, how much algorithmic fairness, what kind of data property rights, what kind of user engagement in sort of key decision making, and finally, what kind of due process to give people who feel like the system has wronged them. Because these digital institutions aren't designing themselves, they're being consciously designed, and we have to participate in their design, because otherwise the world that is going to be designed for us is not going to be a world that we want to live in. Thank you.